Good morning, students. Today we have to start from page 49. This paragraph, that is the second paragraph, but it was all he could do. But it was all he could do, hold its body encircled in his arms and sit there. Right? So you remember he tried to strangle the dog, he tried to kill the dog and put his hands inside him. Right? This was the idea which came to his head. This is what he intended to do. This is what he wanted to do. So he somehow managed to to bring the dog near himself. The dog came. The dog came near him. And he tried to take out his knife and kill the dog. But again, because his fingers were numb, they were stiff because of the cold, he was not able to move his fingers, so he was unable to do so. The only thing which he was able to do so was encircle the dog in his and he cannot kill the dog obviously like that, right? So body encircled in his arms and sit there. He realized that he could not kill the dog. So finally he realized that he will not be able to kill the dog. There was no way to do it. How will he kill the dog when his fingers, they are not moving, the wires are down? So with his helpless hands, he could neither draw nor hold the sheath knife, nor throttle the animal. Throttle means to choke, right? Kill someone by choking, to strangle someone. That is, so he was not able to take out his knife and throttle the animal. So nothing was possible for him. So he released it. So he released the dog, left dog. And it plunged wildly away with his with tail between its legs and still snarling. Still the dog was making that growling sound. Right, because this kind of behavior he had never seen. This kind of behavior was never seen by the dog. It had never seen this kind of behavior. So again, he was making those strange whining, snarling sound. It halted 40 feet away and surveyed him curiously, with ears sharply pricked forward. So his ears were pricking forward, and he looked at the man carefully because he was trying to understand this kind of behavior of the man. This was something new to him. The man looked down at his hands in order to locate them. You know, why did he have to look down to in order to locate his hands? Because there was absolutely no sensation left in his hands. So he had to use his eyes to see if his hands were actually there. Right? So in order to find his hands, he had to look down and found them hanging on the ends of his arms. It struck him as curious that one should have to use his eye. So this was something which was very strange to the man, that you have to use your hand and use your eyes to locate your hands. Till now he has never experienced this kind of thing, right? So but now what was happening to him, he had to use his power of sight to locate his parts of the body. Earlier there was sensation, so you know where your hands are. Without even looking at your hands, you can place your hands wherever you want. But now it was not possible for the man to do it because his hands were lifeless and they were just hanging at the bottom of his arms. It struck him as curious. So this was something very strange for the man, that one should have to use his eyes in order to find out where his hands were. He began threshing his arms back and forth, beating the mittened hands against his side. So again he started threshing his arms, trying to making his best efforts to revive the sensation in his hands. He did this for 5 minutes, violently, and his heart pumped enough blood up to the surface to put a stop to his shivering. So when he did this for almost 5 minutes, his heart pumped blood and the shivering. Till now he was shivering also. So the shivering stopped. At least the shivering of his body, it stopped. But no sensation aroused in his hands. means his hands were now permanently damaged, right? They were frozen. Now, no matter how hard he tried to hit his hand, there was no sensation. Even after hitting for 5 minutes, there was no sensation in his hands. The sensation was not revived in his hands, and so he had an impression that they hung like weight, that they hung like weights at the end of his arms. But when he tried to run the impression down, he could not run. Right. So there was something in his mind which told him that his hands are hanging at the end of his arms. Right. But when he tried to run that thought in his mind, he couldn't feel any sensation. See, your mind is responsible for letting you feel all the sensations, right? The sensation of touch teaches your mind through the nerves. But because the nerves which were there in that part of his body, inside those hands, what happened? They were down. The nerve wires, they were down, right? So he was not able to feel anything. A certain fear of death. So this was the first time that the fear of death came inside. So a certain fear of death, dull and oppressive, came to him. Right? So first time he started realizing that he was about to die. This fear quickly became poignant, and he realized that it was no longer a matter of freezing his fingers and toes or of losing his hands and feet, but that it was a matter of life and death, with the chances against him. So this was the first time that he realized that his chances of survival are very bleak, and there is high probability that he will lose his life. Till now, what he was thinking, that at the most he will lose a few of his fingers and a few of his toes. Slowly what happened, his entire hands and feet were almost frozen. Right? But now slowly that fear started creeping inside him, that it is definitely not the matter of losing a few fingers or losing your entire hands and feet. It is a matter of life and death. So this was the first time that he realized the gravity of the situation. Right? Till now he was very confident, kind of overconfident. He thought that this weather, these temperatures will not be able to harm him in any way. But now slowly that fear of death started creeping inside him. Right? And he slowly understood that the chances of his survival are very less. This threw him into a panic. And see, the moment you become negative about something, you start panicking. So the same thing happened to this man. Now the negativity started coming inside his mind. It started taking control of his mind. This threw him into panic, and he turned and ran up the creek bed along the old stone trail. So he started running. The dog joined in behind and kept up with him. He ran blindly without sensation. He just now was trying to save his life. He forgot about the sensation in his hand and feet. So he just started running blindly without thinking anything. Why? Because now he has to fight death, which was fast approaching, right? So without intention, without anything in mind, without any intention, he just started running blindly in fear, such in fear as he had never known in life. So this kind of fear he faced first time in his life. That is the fear of death, right? So he started running blindly without any intention. And he turned and ran up the creek bed along the old stone trail. The dog joined it behind and kept up with him. Right? So the dog maintained pace with him. He ran blindly without intention in fear such as he had never known in his life. Slowly, as he plowed and floundered through the snow, he began to see things again. So plowed and floundered means he just moved he was moving in a way, floundering means to move with a lot of difficulty. See, why was he not able to run properly? Because there was no sensation in his feet. His feet were already wet and frozen. So when his feet, what will happen if your feet will be numb? At times when you sit in a particular posture, your feet go numb. So how do you feel? You try to stand up, you feel that there is no contact between the earth or the ground on which you are standing and your feet. Right? Even if you stand, you don't feel as if you are standing and your feet are touching the ground. So the same thing was with this man. There was no sensation in his feet. So he was able, not able to walk properly. Right? So he was floundering and plowed through the snow. He was just moving through that area which was covered with snow. He began to see things again. And because he was running blindly, so the blood circulation increased in his body. And so he began to see things again. The banks of the creek, the old timber jam, the leafless aspens. Aspens are a type of trees, right? And the sky. Aspen are the type of trees whose leaves, they move a lot when the wind blows. The running made him feel better. So because of running, the blood circulation increased and it made him feel better. He did not shiver. So his shivering also stopped. Maybe if he ran on, his feet will thaw. So he thought of this, that if he kept on running, his feet will thaw out and sensation will be back in his feet. And anyway, if he ran far enough, he would reach camp and the boys. So the next thought which came to his mind was that if he continued running, he will be able to reach the camp. If he continued running in this manner, he will be able to reach the camp. Without doubt, he would lose some fingers and toes and some of his face. But the boys would take care of him and save the rest of him when he got there. So he was aware of this fact that he will have to lose some part of his hand, some part of his feet, and even some part of his face, because his nose was also numb and the cheekbones, they were also numb. So these few parts of his body he will have to lose. But again, there will be boys in the camp who will take care of him and will give him some medical aid. So he will be fine. At least his life will be saved. These were the thoughts which were coming to his mind. And at the same time, there was another thought in his mind that said he would never get to the camp in the camp. So along with this positivity, along with this optimism that he will be able to, if he keeps on running, he will be able to reach the camp. And if he keeps on running, he will be able to thaw his feet. So one part of his brain was telling him this, that if he kept on running, everything will be fine and things will be okay. There was another thought which was parallel to this optimistic thought in his mind, and which told him that no matter how hard he tries, he will not be able to reach the boys in the camp. Why? Because the distance was too much. The distance which he has to cover is too much for him to keep on running with his feet frozen. Get to the camp and the boys, that it was too many miles, because he has to cover too many miles and his condition will not allow him to run such a great distance. That the freezing had too great a start on him. Already the freezing has started showing its influence over him, and so he will not be able to run too far. And so this thought, this negative thought was also there in his mind along with the positive one. And that he would soon be stiff and dead. So slowly that thought of death, end of life, was coming into his mind. This thought he kept in the background and refused to consider. He tried to avoid that thought, the thought of death, the thought that negative thought which was continuously coming into his mind. He tried to avoid it. He tried his level best not to think about it. Right? And remain optimistic. Sometimes it pushed itself forward and demanded to be heard. But that thought was so prominent that it demanded to be heard. Right? But he thrust it back and strove to think of other things. So just to avoid that negative thought, the thought of his death, he started thinking about other things. Right? He didn't want to concentrate on that negative thought, the thought of his death. which was trying hard to take over all the positivity in his mind. It struck him as curious that he had run at all on feet so frozen that he could not feel them when they struck the earth and took the weight of his body. So this was something very curious for him, that he was running on his feet and he was not even feeling it. It was like gliding over the ice, right? When you will not feel any sensation, what kind of feeling you will have? As if you are slipping and gliding over the ice. So he didn't even realize that his feet were carrying that entire weight of his body when they were striking the ground, because there was no sensation in his feet. He seemed to himself to skim along above the surface. So that's what I said, that the feeling which came inside him was that he was skimming along the surface of the ice. Skimming along means sliding and gliding over the surface of the ice, and to have no connection with the earth. So he didn't feel any connection with the earth. Somewhere he had once seen a winged Mercury, and he wondered if Mercury felt as he felt when skimming over the earth. You must have seen Mercury, how it slips over the surface, right? So the thought which came to him was of Mercury. See, he was trying to think about other things just to avoid the thought of his death, his approaching death, right? He didn't want to think about death. He wanted to live. So these were the things which he started thinking about. He was reminded of Mercury, that the way the Mercury slides over the surface. So he is walking in a similar manner. He is also gliding over the surface without any kind of sensation in his feet. His theory of running until he reached the camp and the boys had one flaw. There was one defect in this theory of running and reaching the boys in the camp. He lacked endurance. This theory lacked endurance. Several times he stumbled and finally he crumpled up and fell. So this is what happened. This was not a very enduring theory. Right? See, it will be very difficult for him to run miles when there was no sensation in his feet. So he stumbled several times. When you try to walk or even stand up, you have a feeling that you will fall down, right? And if your feet are numb and you start running, what will happen? You will obviously stumble, fall, right? Totter. Tottering means not able to walk properly, right? And crumpled means he to bend and fall down. So these were the things which happened to him. Several times he stumbled and fell. When he tried to rise, he failed. And then when he fell down and tried to stand up again, he failed. Why? Because there was no sensation in his limbs, like the hand and feet. He must sit and rest, he decided. And next time, he would merely walk and keep on. So he thought of making some improvement in his plan, and he said that he should just sit and rest. And after some time, he should get up and start walking instead of running, because the chances of falling down are more when you run with your feet numb. So he decided that now he will just get up and keep on walking instead of running. He gave up the idea of running. As he sat and regained his breath, he noted that he was feeling quite warm and tired. So, because he had been running, so the blood circulation increased in his body, and so he started feeling warm and comfortable also. He was not shivering, and it even seemed that a warm glow had come to his chest and trunk. So the blood which shrank into the dark corners of his body, it again came out because it received the warmth because of his running, and so the blood now started reaching the surface of the body, and so there was a glow to his chest and the trunk, that is the upper portion of his body. And yet, when he touched his nose or cheeks, there was no sensation. So now these were the areas which were permanently damaged. No matter what he does, the sensation will not be revived in these areas. That is the nose, cheeks, fingers, toes. These were the parts of his body which were permanently damaged and they cannot be saved now. He will have to do away with them. Running would not thaw them out. So he realized that running would not thaw them out. They will not be warmed by running and the sensation will not be revived in these parts. Nor would it thaw out his hand and feet. So he was aware of this fact also that he will have to get his hands and feet also removed from his body because they were like frozen now. Then the thought came to him that the frozen portions of his body must be extended. See, then again the negativity creeped inside him. When he started thinking about his hands and feet, and he realized that his hands, feet, and the cheeks and nose, they are without sensation, even in spite of the fact that he ran for such a great distance. So he finally realized that maybe that freezing which has started inside his body, that is extending, that is continuously increasing and covering other parts of his body, trying to capture other areas of his body also. That has started extending to different parts of the body. He tried to keep this thought down. So again, he made efforts to keep away this thought, this negative thought, to forget it, to think of something else. He was aware of the panicky feeling that it caused. So any kind of negative thought, what does it do? It brings that panicky feeling inside you, right? Feeling of stress, the feeling of tension. So he was aware of this fact, and so he tried to keep away that thought from his mind. But the thought asserted itself. But slowly what happened? The thought became more and more dominant, more and more powerful, and that negative thought asserted itself again and again. Didn't matter how hard he tried to keep it away and persisted. And thought was there, it refused to go away from his mind until it produced a vision of his body totally frozen. So what happened? It made him visualize his body totally frozen. Any thought which is very prominent in your mind, it will make you visualize that particular thing. Right? So now the thought became so powerful that he was able to have a vision of his body totally frozen. That is, he had visions of his death. This was too much. And he made another wild run along the trail. So what did he do? He got more scared, and so he stood up and started running once again because he didn't want to die. So once he slowed down to walk, but the thought of freezing extending itself made him run again. So once he tried to slow down because he was tired, and but again the moment he slowed down and started walking, that thought that his entire body will freeze in some time, it came again inside his mind, and he again started running. And all the time, the dog ran with him at his knees. So the dog was following him all this while. When he was running, when he was walking, when he was falling, then also the dog was near. It was just quietly following this man. When he fell down a second time, it curled its tail over its forefeet and sat in front of him, facing him, curiously eager and intent. Why eager and intent? Because now when the man fell down the next time, he thought that the man will stop here. What was the yearning of the dog? What did the dog desire? There was only one desire which was inside that dog, and what was it? Who can tell you? What did the dog want? The moment the man sat down or
fire.
Fire.
Fire. The dog's only desire was the fire, because the dog has considered man to be the fire provider and the food provider. So the moment the man fell down, he just sat down there, curled his tail, again expecting that now this man is going to build fire and do some good things to him by providing him with the warmth of the fire. He curiously eager and intent. The warmth and security of the animal entered. Now see, the man started feeling jealous of the dog. Because the dog is the creature of the nature, right? He never attempts to go against nature. So he was warm. Nature has made him like this to survive in such cold temperatures, right? So the warmth and security of the dog, which provided safety to that animal, that angered this man, that annoyed this man. And he cursed it till it flattened down its ears appeasingly. So the dog, what did it do? The man started cursing. And because this cursing was something which was very natural to the dog, right? He had always seen this man whiplashing him with his tongue and cursing him, not talking to him properly, being impolite to him. So this made the dog happy because he was used to this kind of treatment by this man. So it flattened down its ears appeasingly. So appeasingly means pleasantly. Right? So the dog felt pleasant about it, but now the man is normal. He is behaving in a normal manner because he was cursing him, and so pleasantly flattened down his ears. This time the shivering came more quickly upon the man. He was losing in his battle with frost. It was creeping into his body from all sides. So this time when the man stopped, when he fell on the snow, the shivering came more quickly than the last time. And there was more amount of negativity also in his mind. He realized that he was losing his battle against this frost. Right? Slowly that realization dawned upon him that no matter how hard he tries, he will not be able to live. It was creeping into his body from all sides. So he felt that that freezing was creeping into his body from all sides. The thought of it drove him on, but he ran no more than 100 feet. So again, because the moment that thought came to his mind, he used to start running. So again, when he realized that his body is freezing from all sides, he again got up and tried to run, but this time he was not able to run for a great distance, and he just fell down after running for approximately 100 feet. When he staggered and pitched headlong. Pitched headlong means he fell headlong. Headlong means first his head and then the rest of his body. Even the head is leading and you fall. So he pitched headlong. It was his last panic. So this was his last panic. Now, this will be the stage when he will finally give up his battle against death. When he had recovered his breath and control, he sat up and entertained in his mind the conception of meeting death with dignity. So till now, what he was doing, he was trying to resist that thought of death, which was coming into his mind. But now he decided, he surrendered himself and he decided to accept that the death which was approaching with dignity. Why? Because he finally realized that no matter what he does, he will not be able to save his life. So it's better to accept. When you cannot do anything about the situation, the best thing would be to accept that particular thing in a dignified manner. So this was the first time that when he sat down, because he fell headlong, right? So he just sat down, and when his breath was normal, because he had been running, he sat up and he entertained in his mind the conception of meeting his death with dignity. So he accepted that thought against which he was fighting all this while. However, the conception did not come to him in such time. His idea of it was that he had been making a fool of himself. So he finally realized that till now he was making a fool of himself by running, by falling several times, right? Because anyhow he had to die. running around like a chicken with it. So this was the comparison which he used for himself. That till now, by running with his frozen feet and hands, till now, what he was doing was just making a fool of himself, like a chicken whose head has been chopped off. When you chop off the head of a chicken, what happens? There is some life left inside his body for some time. So that the rest of his body moves quickly here and there for some time before it finally falls. So he fell. And this is a comparison. This is a comparison which he used for himself. That he was, his situation was just like a chicken whose head has been chopped off. So if the head of a chicken has been chopped off, what does it mean? That the chicken has to ultimately die. Will a chicken live without the head? No. The only thing what the rest of the body does was to run here and there in an attempt to be alive. So that is what the man had been doing till now. He was just fooling himself when he knew that he had to die. Such was the simile that occurred to him. So this was the comparison which came to his mind, that his situation was just like a chicken whose head has been chopped off. Well, he was bound to freeze anyway. So he finally realized that no matter what he does, he was bound. He was destined to freeze anyway. And he might as well take it easy. So when something is destined to happen, the best thing would be to stop resisting that. So he decided to not to resist death anymore and accept it in a dignified manner with peace and sense. With this newfound peace. And see, once you accept something, once your mind ends that revolt against a particular thought, what happens? There is peace. Right? There is commotion and chaos in your mind only when you are trying to resist, when you are trying to revolt against a particular thought. But once there is acceptance, what happens? Slowly, your mind becomes peaceful and adjusts to that particular thing. So the same thing happened to this man. Once he finally accepted the thought of his death, once he finally realized that he has to die, and he surrendered himself before his death, there was peace in his mind. Came the first glimmerings of darkness. And once he accepted his death and his mind was peaceful, what happened? He started feeling drowsy and sleepy. So small amount of sleepiness started coming inside. A good idea, he thought, to sleep off today. So these were the thoughts which were coming into his mind, that it is a good idea to sleep off to bed, because he was very tired and he was feeling sleepy. It was like taking an anesthetic. So it would be like taking an anesthetic. You will not feel any pain of death, and slowly he will die in sleep. Freezing was not so bad as people thought. So he also realized that freezing was not a bad idea to die. There were lots of worse ways to die. He pictured the boys. And then in that semi-drowsy state, when his mind was in that semi-drowsy state, what happened? He started picturing the boys finding his body next day. Suddenly he found himself with them, coming along the trail and looking for himself. So he imagined that his soul is there with the boys, and the boys which were there in the camp, they have reached this particular place to find his body. And this man's soul is also there. He could see himself coming along with the boys to find his own body lying in the snow. He did not belong with himself anymore, for even then he was out of himself. And when he pictured himself with the boys, he felt that he doesn't belong. Right? His soul has separated from his body. He doesn't belong to himself. Right? He has left his body. He did not belong with himself anymore, for even then he was out of himself. So he started feeling that he was out of himself. He was out of his own body, standing with the boys and looking at himself in this way. Why? Because he could imagine himself looking at his own body, standing with the boy. It certainly was cold, was his thought. When he got back to the States, he could tell the folks what real cold was. And these were the thoughts. These were strange thoughts which were coming into his mind in that semi-conscious state, right? Because he was approaching death, he was very tired, drowsiness had started taking hold over him. So his mind was not functioning properly, right? So these were the thoughts which were coming into him. He even thought that when he will go back to the States, he will tell his people how cold it could be, because this was really very cold weather which he had seen for the first time in his life. He drifted on from this to a vision of the old timer. Then the next thought which came to his mind was of the old timer on the Selkar tree. Right? You remember that old timer who advised him not to go in such cold weather without a companion. He could see him quite clearly, warm and comfortable, smoking a pipe. So he imagined himself as warm and comfortable, smoking a pipe. You were right, old horse. You were right. The man mumbled to the old timer of the Selkar tree. So in his thoughts, he mumbled to the old timer, right? Spoke to the old timer that you were right. Earlier, what was his opinion? That the old timer was a fool. When he was able to build the fire, what was his opinion? That the old timer was a coward, he was a fool. Only fools and cowards, they think that they need a companion to travel in such cold weather. But now he accepted the view of the old timer. When he was about to die, he finally realized that the old timer, the advice which was given by the old timer was correct. Then the man drowsed off into what seemed to him the most comfortable, satisfying sleep he had ever known. So it means that the man finally died. The dog sat facing him in the evening, a brief day due to the close in a long, slow time. So it was the end of the day. It was becoming dark. And the dog was sitting near the man. There were no signs of a fire to be built. Dog was sitting next to the man, expecting him to build the fire, because his only desire was fire at the moment. So, but slowly he gave up hope and he felt that there were no signs of fire to be made. And besides, never in the dog's experience he had known, and this was the first time that he was seeing the man to sit like that in the snow and make no fire. So this was something which the dog has not experienced in the past. I told you, animals, they follow a routine. Anything which is new to them makes them suspicious. Any kind of behavior which is new to them makes them suspicious. Right? So he has never seen a man in his life sitting on the snow like this without making an attempt to build the fire. So this was something very strange for the dog. As the twilight drew on, its eager yearning for the fire mastered. So as it was becoming dark, so becoming dark means colder. So its desire for the fire increased. And with a great lifting and shifting of his forefeet, it whined softly. Then flattened its ears down in anticipation of being chidden by the man. And then with twisting his body here and there, lifting his limbs and shifting his body, what he did, what the dog did, it stood up. And then when it stood up, it was standing there, he expected the man to scold him. Right? He expected some kind of chiding by the man. But the man was dead. But the man remained silent. But the man didn't scold him, didn't shout at him. So again, this was another abnormal behavior for the dog, because he was used to it. Later, the dog whined loudly. So the dog started whining, making sounds loudly. And still later, it crept close to the man. But still, when there was no response from this man, it went close to the man and caught the scent of death. Right? So once it went next, very close to the man, it could smell the scent of death. This made the animal bristle and back. So this made the animal kind of angry and irritated, and it moved back. A little longer it delayed, howling under the stars that leaped and danced and shone brightly in the cold sky. So it stayed there for some more time. A little longer it delayed there, went on howling under the stars, because the stars were already there in the sky, and leaped and danced and shone, that the stars which were dancing and shining brightly in the cold sky. The dog was howling, standing under those stars. And then it turned and trotted up the trail in the direction of the camp. Because the dog was acquainted with the camp, he knew the way to the camp, and so it turned and started moving towards the camp. Trotting means quick, sharp, taking quick, sharp steps, right? So it trotted up the trail, that is the path, in the direction of the camp it knew. Where were the other food providers and the fire giver? Because the dog wanted to be with the food providers and the fire givers who could satisfy his desire for the fire. So he left the man there and started moving in the direction of the camp, because he needed fire to survive, and it needed fire to survive, and it needed food to survive. So he went to the other people who could provide him with these things. Those were the boys in the camp. With this, we come to the end of the story. Finally,